Giver of life, Lord, we just thank you for all that you give us. Let's pray for the message that you would speak to hearts this morning, and we just want to enjoy you today, Lord, and lift you up. In your name we pray, our Lord Jesus. Amen. If you can all stand. Deanna and I need to hear your voices this morning.
Remember your children, remember. I heard morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Pine Valley Community Church. How is everybody today?
Good.
All right. Wow. You need me louder, right? Yes? No? Maybe so? We would love for you to take out your bulletins. We got a few announcements. We also have connection cards to fill out, which are very, very important means of communication. You can fill those out. Let us know you're here. Let us know if you have any prayer requests, if you have any questions about the church, or if you need to be contacted about anything. That would be a great place to write that down. And that can be turned in at the end of service when the offering plates are passed around. Pretty cool day today. Good weekend. It is Veterans Day weekend. Big deal there, right? And so I wanted to just take a little bit of time and just think about where we're at. Think of all the great blessings and freedoms we get to enjoy. All the wonderful things we're allowed to complain about. All the different wonderful things we have as part of living in this country. And so much of that is due to veterans that have gone in and fought for those freedoms, gone out and fought for those freedoms. I have a quote here from Ronald Reagan, and it says, "Veterans know better than anyone else the price of freedom, for they've suffered the scars of war. We can offer them no better tribute than to protect what they have won for us." So we would just love to give a hand to any veterans. I'm not going to force you to stand up because we've done some things. I don't want to give them an extra stand. But we are very, very grateful. We praise the Lord just for this great place that we get to live in. We praise the Lord for this wonderful church. You see all these boxes over here and right here? Packing party for Operation Christmas Child was a blast. Lots and lots of boxes. There's some information there if you have some boxes to still donate, or if you wanted to still be able to get involved. There's a drop-off spot at the Bethel Christian Assembly in Alpine throughout this week. The hours are all listed there, and would just love to thank Mary Aragon and her family just for putting on this great ministry for so many years. Do we even know how many years we've been doing this, Mary? 12 years. Wow, that's a long time. And what's the exact amount of boxes we've given over those 12 years?
Oh, gosh.
lots and lots of boxes. I've told this before, but there was one time where the church got some messages from another part of the country, and it was kids actually opening the boxes that came from Pine Valley Community Church. And it was just such a blessing. Did I say another part of the country? Another part of the world. Another country. Just amazing, and they were so thankful, and to be able to have, we've had students leave notes in some of those boxes before, and get letters back from kids that got their actual box, so it's the real deal. It is a great ministry. We are in the midst of our Christmas season. We've got Camp Christmas coming up at the Pine Valley Bible Conference Center, which is also very cool. Free entry for locals. They also let people from our church in. If you don't necessarily live in Pine Valley, but you're from Pine Valley Community Church, we can get you in free as well on those dates that are listed in the bulletin. We operate a ticket booth for the locals on those special locals nights. Everybody receives an invitation to our Christmas Eve service, and they also get a little gift bag from the church. And so we need some volunteers to be able to man up that ticket booth on those locals nights. It's really fun. It's not cold at all, ever. It's never cold. But on the nights that it's not cold, it's because it's probably windy. So great opportunity to volunteer, just be a part of the local church, meet new people, and see them off as they go into Camp Christmas and give them a little gift. So there's a sign-up sheet in the connecting point for that. We would love for you to put your name down on that. Again, there's 10 nights. I think next weekend is the first weekend, so 17th, 18th, and 19th. Last I saw for next weekend, the 18th is still available. So fight your way into that connecting point between services and sign up for next weekend. That would be absolutely awesome. Much more can be said. I've got another picture to show you guys. A friend I would like to introduce all of you to. The guy on the left is named Chuck. And that's his daughter, Trinity, and his son, James, and his wife, Karen. And that's our new pastor.
Awesome.
And they are going to be arriving in January. And we we have told you as we've led up to this and as we've prayed, that we've just really felt great about the process, about our relationship with Village Missions, which is the organization that our church is a part of. And as we came into contact with Chuck just a couple months ago and the meetings and the conversations, they actually live in El Cajon, so it's been very easy to have personal contact with them. And I will let him, when he comes, share all about his history. He actually grew up on a farm in a small, small town in Oregon. He's done ministry in the Pacific Northwest. He's also been a part as an associate pastor of a church down here in San Diego. Went back up to the Northwest and different things like that. There's a lot I could tell you, but we as elders, and you can ask us questions. Now that it's out, feel free to ask questions. But we just feel like the gifts that this family brings are very fitting to where our church is at right here, right now. And we're so excited, not just for them to start in January, but because they live just down the hill, they're going to begin attending Green Valley Community Church on November 26th. And they're going to be here all through December. Yeah, that's worth clapping. This is like, if you don't know the history of Pine Valley Community Church, normally we haven't pursued this option with Village Missions as far as searching out candidates ourselves and maybe talking to different local guys and stuff like that. It's normally, we found your pastor, he's going to be there in a couple weeks. And many people, the first time they see or have any contact with their pastor is when he comes up here to preach his first message. So for them to be able to be here, become a part of the body beforehand, before officially starting. We'll have a moving day into the parsonage, so you guys can help out with that. We'll announce all that stuff. On the 26th, this isn't in the bulletin, but on the 26th, we're looking at doing a potluck after the service. Probably all your Thanksgiving leftovers would be fine. If you just want to bring all of that on Sunday the 26th, that would be great. We will send out an email with some different signups for the potluck, and we'll have a sheet in there next week for that too. But we want to welcome them, get to know them. There's one more picture of them, just to prove that they're a good fit for this church. I like how Pastor Chuck, we'll call him, is just kind of gripping his family, like holding them together. I don't know if he's like preventing them from falling into the pool behind them, or what it is. I'm sure there's a pastoral analogy there, but I've gotten to know him very, very well. We actually went to a two-day conference together last month, and I had met him previously, years ago, for a short period of time. Neither of us really remembered him. Well, I remember him, but he didn't remember me. But he likes Bruce, and he's a memorable guy, so. But we are very excited. Pastor Chuck and Karen Whitney is their last name. Their kids are 16, and Trinity is 18. James is 16, Trinity is 18. So, very cool. You can pray for them. You've got a face now. You've got names. And like I said, they will be here starting on November 26th, which is super cool. Middle schoolers, you are with us in the high school class today. Sorry, you got to listen to me teach. And other than that, why don't you get up and meet and greet somebody around you? Super exciting. Great day. Happy Sunday, everybody.
Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? Good? Praise the Lord. Good to see you here this morning, and I just want to say thank you to all those veterans. Thank you if you've served our country. You know, I get to come up here once in a while and boldly preach the gospel, but there's a reason I get to do that. That costs somebody something for me to be able to do that. Someone has paid the price in order that we can boldly preach the gospel. We can go out and do that because of what a veteran has done for us. So we just want to thank him this morning. Let's just open up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word, just for how practical it is in our lives, Lord. And as we open up the book of James this morning, we just ask that you continue to be our teacher. Father, we just thank you for the worship leaders. Lord, we thank you for the sound team. We thank you for our Bible study teachers who are teaching this morning, our youth. Thank you for Pastor Jeff and our elders. Lord, we're so grateful for Pastor Chuck and Karen coming, and we just pray that you would even now be preparing their hearts, Lord. Prepare us Help us to get ready to minister to them as well, Lord, as they're part of our family. Lord, we thank you again as we open up your word. We just ask that you would just bless each and every person who's here this morning, that you'd speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Make sure you pray for Pastor Chuck and Karen. Keep them in your prayers throughout the rest of November and December as they're preparing to come. It's going to be an exciting time. So we're getting to the last part of James chapter 4, and it's a very short, practical little part of James that we're going to talk about this morning. And it's a very familiar part of James. It's probably some of the verses you've heard many times. And yet I notice sometimes when there are verses that are familiar to us, we kind of get to think, well, we know that verse pretty well, and so maybe we don't allow the Lord to speak to us the way we should through that verse. So let's just kind of slowly go through these verses this morning and just let the Lord speak to our hearts. Really, in James chapter 4, 13 through 17, what James is talking about is God's will in our lives, allowing God's will to be in our lives. If you remember, in Mark chapter 3, Jesus had been healing. He had healed a number of people, and then afterwards, his mother and his brother came and wanted to talk to him, and he was addressing some people. And Jesus asked the question, they said, are your mother and brother here? And Jesus asked the question, who's my mother and who are my brothers? Then he looked at those around him and said, look, these are my mother and brothers. Anyone who does the will of God is my brother and sister and mother. So Jesus is telling us, if we truly want to be related to him, we do God's will. When we're doing God's will, we're truly related to him. More than the physical people were who were on this earth at that time. That's how important God's will is in our lives. And again, last week we talked about, and James talked about some true characteristics of a Christian. I can't think of a truer characteristic of a Christian than someone who's in the will of God. Someone who's concerned about the will of God. Someone who wants to follow the will of God in their life. That's truly something that makes you a Christian, when you are in the center of God's will. David said in Psalm chapter 40, verse 8, I take joy in doing your will, my God, for your instructions are written in my heart. David said, it's a joyous thing for me to follow the will of God. I want to follow the will of God because it's going to bring joy into my life. And in Psalm 143, verse 10, David said, teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your gracious spirit lead me forward on a firm footing. So David said a couple things about it. He said it's going to be a joyous thing. And he said when we're in God's will, we're on firm footing. There's nowhere else we should want to be as a Christian but in the will of God. And Jesus showed there's a link in our relationship between God and his will. In John chapter 7, verse 17, Jesus said, anyone who wants to do the will of God will know whether my teaching is from God or merely my own. There's a connection there. And again, James often tells us what true believers do. And one of those things is they want the will of God in their life. It's kind of been true for believers all along. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 2, Peter said, you won't spend the rest of your lives chasing your own desires, but you will be anxious to do the will of God. You'll be anxious to do the will of God. You're going to want to do God's will. The Apostle John put it this way in 1 John 2:17, the world is passing away, and also its lusts. But the one who does the will of God continues to live forever. The one who does the will of God, the true Christian, lives forever because he's wanting to do the will of God. And Jesus really was the ultimate example of someone on earth doing God's will. The ultimate example for you and I is Jesus. That's what he came into the world to do. In John chapter 4, Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of God who sent me and to accomplish his work." I'm going to give you one more before we start in James. In John chapter 5, verse 30, Jesus said, "I can do nothing on my own. I judge as God tells me. Therefore, my judgment is just because I carry out the will of the one who sent me, not my own will." You realize, if you ever wonder how God would react to something, just look at Jesus. When you look at Jesus, you're seeing God's will carried out in a human body. A human being who was God carrying his will. He's mirroring what he saw the Father doing in heaven. So I wanted to read you all those verses as we start to go. I guess I have to turn it on. As we start to go in James. Beginning in verse 13. James chapter 4, we're beginning in verse 13. And by the way, we're almost done with James. There's only two more messages after this. There'll be two more messages in James. Then we'll be in Advent. Jeff will be preaching the first Advent. I'll do the next two. Jeff will do the last one. And then we're going to have Pastor Chuck. So we're finishing up James here. In verse 13, he says, "Look here, you who say, today or tomorrow, we're going to be going to a certain town, and we'll stay there a year, and we'll do business there, and we'll make a profit." James starts off by saying, "Look here. Look here." He's trying to get our attention in a very bold way. He's saying, listen to what I'm saying. The Amplified Bible says, pay attention. Pay attention to what I'm saying. And James is saying, he's talking about this business person that kind of leaves God out of their plans. And I call it this way. I call it being a practical atheist. A practical atheist. And you know, I hate to say it, but the church is full of practical atheists. There's a lot of people that come on Sunday, but are they concerned about what the will of God is for their life Monday through Friday? There's a lot of people that aren't following God's will in their lives. They come to church every Sunday. And James uses the example of this business person who's making their plans. See, in the New Testament, that was, during those times, it was a very common thing. You'd sell your products in one city, and then maybe after you've been there for a year or so, everybody's kind of bought what you have, you'd move on to another city. And then you'd sell your goods there. That was kind of something that happened. And let me say, first off, there's nothing wrong with making plans. So don't misunderstand what I'm saying. If you go into business and you don't have a plan, it's probably going to be a disaster. It's not what we're talking about. We're not saying, hey, just go into business and I hope it works out. We're saying God should be at the center of your plan. God should be at the center of everything you do. So don't think we're saying don't plan. That's not what James is saying. The attitude that James is challenging here is this man is making a plan without God. This man's making a plan without God. See, he's talking about what's going to happen in the future. I'm going to go here, and I'm going to go there, and I'm going to make a profit, and I'm going to do this. And God's not in the plan. Where's God in this plan? His business plan seems to be ignoring God. Charles Spurgeon asked the question, did the business person say today or tomorrow we'll go into this town and do this for the glory of God? Did he say, I've got my business plan set out and the most important thing in my business, even before making a profit, I want to glorify God? Is that the way he laid out his business plan? That's going to give you a successful business. And he says that we're going to stay there a year and we're going to make a profit. So the business person's pretty confident in what he's going to do. But you know something? When you make a plan like that without God, you know what you're doing? You're making yourself God. You're making yourself God. You're saying, I'm going to go make this plan, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do that, and God's left out of your plans. In Luke chapter 12, Jesus told this story. He said a rich man had a fertile farm that produced fine crops. He said to himself, "What should I do? I don't have room for all my crops." This guy had so much, the barns are overflowing. I don't even have room for all my stuff. Then he said, "I know. I'll tear down my barns and I'll build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and other goods. And I'll sit back and say to myself, 'My friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Now take it easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you worked for?' Yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth, but not have a rich relationship with God." That's what Jesus said. See, when you make plans and you leave God out, you could be in for a huge surprise. I knew a man, and he had liver cancer. He was going to work, going about his daily stuff, had worked hard all his life. And he went to work that day, and he was supposed to, that afternoon, come home, go to the hospital, and they were going to test his liver functions. But the thing was, they weren't supposed to put contrast in the test, the dye they used, because his liver was shot. And they made a mistake, and they put the contrast into his test. And we got a phone call. So I got 48 hours to live, and they told him that after, "You've got 48 hours, because that's going to blow your liver up." Big mistake. He went home that morning. He went to work that morning thinking he's just going to come home and have another night. He never left that hospital. They gave him 48 hours, and that's about exactly what he got. That man had $2 million in the bank. You could spend your whole life saving up, thinking, "I'm going to have this rich retirement. I'm going to do all these things. I'm going to build these bigger barns, and I'm going to fill them up." I knew another man. This is a guy I used to work with, and I knew him from my 20s on, and he was a great guy, and he was always talking about saving money. He was always asking me, "How's your 401k doing?" And he was always trying to get me to save money, and he did a great job of doing that. He was a real interesting guy. Whenever he'd date someone, he'd always see what their credit score was before he got too serious about it. This guy was serious. He cracked me up. I love this guy. And he always used to tease me about church, you know, going to church all the time, because he was just obsessed with making his money. He went, probably when he's about in his mid-50s, he went out for a motorcycle ride, and he started not to feel good. So he pulled over and he parked underneath a tree. He was with a group of bunch of guys, and he told them, "You guys go on. I'll see you guys in a bit." And they went on, and an hour or so later, he hadn't caught up. So they went back, and he died under that tree. He had a great 401k. But he wasn't planning on the life after this life. See, we don't know. Our life is uncertain. We don't know what tomorrow might bring. He said that your life's like a morning fog. Your translation may say a vapor. It's the Greek word atmes. It means a vapor or a breath, or even like steam on a cold morning in Pine Valley when steam comes out of your mouth. But then when it warms up, there's no more steam. It just goes away, it vanishes. That's what he's comparing our lives like. The NIV says like a mist. The New King James says like a vapor. The Amplified Bible says like a puff of smoke. Just goes away. We don't think of it that way because we just wake up and it's another day. But the idea of our lives being like a shadow or a vapor is mentioned all through the Bible. Psalms 102:11, Job 8:9, 1 Chronicles 29:15. And I never thought of myself that way. You know, when I was younger, 7 days a week I'd get up, I'd lift weights, hit the heavy bag, I'd ride my mountain bike. I thought I was pretty indestructible, to be honest with you, as a young man. I thought that there was nothing that I couldn't overcome with some good exercise and a good diet. And I remember one morning, Karen and I were gonna go on vacation. We were packing up the car, getting ready to go on vacation. I felt like a pretty indestructible guy. And I started to feel like this heat come over my face. It just started to get hot. And it just started getting hotter and hotter. Pretty soon, it felt like somebody was pouring lava over my head. I mean, it just really, this is unbearable. And the next thing I knew, I was on the ground. And the next thing I knew, I was in an ambulance. And like a vapor, my life changed like that. My life's never been the same since that day. It changed like that. I thought I had it all figured out. But our lives can change just like that. And I think that's the first time in my life I realized just how temporary life could be. Just how you can't count on that. See, I thought I was going on vacation, and it turned out my vacation was at Grossmont Hospital. And if you're making travel plans, I just want to tell you, probably not there. There's probably a better place you could go. The food, you know, just the accommodations. Figure out a better place to go. Proverbs 27:1 says, "Don't brag about tomorrow, since you don't know what the day will bring." Don't brag about tomorrow, because we don't even know what the day is going to bring. So much of our lives is beyond our control, and our lives are temporal. We think we're just going to, you know, we can even be guilty of this now. I think of this at times. Well, we'll see. I'm 64, and average life is 72. I'll probably live 10 more years. We start to think in that way. Like we've got it all figured out. Even as Christians, we can fall into this sin, leaving God out. But we're not our own as Christians. We're truly not. If you've given your life to Jesus, 1 Corinthians 16 says, "Don't you realize that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who lives in you and was given to you by God? You do not belong to yourself, for God bought you with a high price. So you must honor God with your body." We're no longer our own. It's no longer all about what we want. Galatians 2:20 says, "My old self has been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God, who loves me and gave himself for me." Remember a while back we studied in Romans chapter 12, verse 1. It said we're to give our bodies to God as a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice to God. Verse 15. So James tells us how we should live. He says, what you ought to say is, if the Lord wants us to, we will live and do this or that. If God wants me to. If God wants me to, that's what I'm going to do. The NIV says, if it's the Lord's will. See, all our decisions should be in submission to God. Our education, our career, our marriage, they should all be in submission to God. What God, if God wants me to, here's what I'm going to do. That's the way we should be as Christians. It's really arrogant for us to leave God out of our plans. Listen, planning without God, beloved, that is original sin. That's what the devil did. He said, I'm going to be like the Most High. He made his own plans. He had his own idea. What did he do to Adam and Eve? He convinced them of the same thing. Went to the garden and said, will God really Did God really say that? He tried to put doubt into their minds. So Adam and Eve fell for his trick. I want to be like God too and know right from wrong. They wanted to be like God. And if you'll notice in the Apostle Paul's writing, he was always, when he talked about his plans, he'd say if it's the Lord's will. Acts 18:21, 1 Corinthians 4:19, 1 Corinthians 16:7. Our plan should always be Lord willing. It's all right to make a plan, but we're going to say, if God allows me to, this is what I'm going to do. If God allows it. Verse 16, otherwise, you're boasting about your own pretentious plans, and all such boasting is evil. See, when we ask Jesus into our lives, we've been bought with a price. We've been purchased by God. And that should affect the way you live. We make it too easy. We make it too easy. Oh, just ask Jesus into your life and then go about your life. And he says, boasting. Otherwise, you're boasting. That word literally means to speak loudly. To speak loudly. You know, I love some old sayings. I think about things we used to say as a kid, and they kind of got out of fashion. We used to call guys loudmouths. That guy's a loudmouth. He's boasting. He can't back it up. He's just a loudmouth, a big mouth. That's kind of what he's talking about here. That's kind of what it sounds like to God when we start making all these big plans and talking about it. Literally, you know what the idea behind this is? Like the quack who would roll into town and he'd want to sell you that tonic and this is going to cure what ails you. That's exactly what this kind of boasting sounds like to God. Like this guy that rolls into town, just buy Mr. Fix-It's juice here and drink it and you're going to be just fine. That's what we sound like when we're boasting about tomorrow. And remember in James, in chapter 1, James said that if you boast, the poor man should boast in how God's honored him. The rich man should boast in how God's humbled him. In other words, all our boasting should be about God. That's the only thing we should really be boasting about. What God is, who God is, and what God's done for us. That's what we should be boasting about. He says that all other boasting is evil. He says it's boasting and it's evil. That word evil, panira. The Greek word panira, and you know what it literally means? Wicked. It's the same word we use to translate the wicked one, Satan. That's exactly, if for no other reason, think about this. This is the comparison here. He says, when you're boasting about tomorrow and leaving God out, it's evil. It's just like the wicked one. It's exactly what he'd do. 1 John 2:16 says, for all that is in the world, the desire of the flesh, the desire of the eyes, and the pride of life is not from the Father, but from the world. We don't want to just be boasting about what we're going to do. And we're starting to see why. In verse 17, which exit are you going to take? God's way or my way? See, we can connect this verse to the verses that James has been saying. Boasting in our arrogance. He says, remember, it is a sin to know what you ought to do and not do it. It's a sin of omission. If you've ever heard that term before, it's a sin of omission. They get it from James 4:17. That's where it came from. It's a sin of not doing something. Not a sin that leads directly, not an action that leads directly to a sin. It's the sin of doing nothing when you should do something. And that's exactly what James is saying here. Remember, it's a sin to know what you ought to do and then not to do it. See, James goes back to that consistent theme that genuine faith has action behind it. We know the right thing to do, and we do it. And knowledge of right and wrong brings responsibility for us. Jesus said in Luke chapter 12, verse 48, "But someone who does not know and then does something wrong will be punished only lightly. When someone has been given much, much will be required. And in return, and when someone has been entrusted with much, even more will be required." So really, the message today is short, and the message is simple today. There's really only one theme that we have here today, and it all boils down to this. As a true believer, God should be at the center of your life. You shouldn't be some sort of practical atheist that just says, yeah, I go to church, but then Monday through Friday, I do whatever I want. It all boils down to this, having God at the center of your life. And then everything's going to fall in place. And I want to say to young people, put God at the center of your education. Put God at the center of your career. Put God at the center of your relationships. When you're ready to get married, put God at the center of your marriage. Make sure that He's the Lord of your life. Make sure that Jesus is the Lord of your life. Take out your bulletin, and let's just take a look at what we've seen this morning. God should be at the center of our lives. Mark chapter 3, verse 33, Psalm chapter 40, verse 8, Psalm 143:10, 1 Peter 4:2. 1 John 2:17, John 4:30, John 5:30. So many scriptures today. I just used a fraction of the scriptures about God's will in our lives, because there's so much in scripture that talks about this. One of the most important things that we should do, having God at the center of our lives. And we shouldn't be boasting about tomorrow, because we're just like that morning fog. James 4:13-14. Luke 12:16-21, Psalm 102:11, Job chapter 8, verse 9, 1 Chronicles 29:15, Proverbs 27:1. And as Christians, you belong to Jesus. You're not your own anymore. You were bought with a price. 1 Corinthians 16:19-20, Galatians 2:20. Our plan should always include the Lord. James 4:15-16. Acts 18:21. 1 Corinthians 4:19. 1 Corinthians 16:7. Because otherwise we're boasting. James 4:16. Acts 4:16-17. And it is a sin for us to know the right thing we should do and then not do it. It's a sin of omission. Knowledge brings responsibility. James chapter 4, verse 17. Luke 12:48. Put Jesus at the center of your life. There's no more important decision you can make than putting Christ at the center of your life and following Him every day. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want You to be at the center of our lives. Help us not to boast about tomorrow, but to realize, Lord, that our lives are in Your hands. We belong to You. Help us never to boast, Lord, unless we're boasting about You. Lord, we thank You for Your Holy Spirit. And we just pray this week that You'll give us one person, Lord, to share Your love with. We ask that You would keep us in the center of Your will, Lord. Thank You so much for all that You do for us. Lord, we just ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
much for this day, and we thank you for this church. We thank you for answered prayer. Lord, we thank you for who you are, that you are in control, that you are the maker, sustainer, redeemer. Lord, you are everything. Father God, we ask that you accept these tithes and offerings. Accept us and use us, Lord. We belong to you. You have bought and paid the price. Use us as you will. Father God, you're incredible. Your plan. We rest within the wisdom of your plan, as the song said. Our only rest. Father, you are the comfort. You are everything. As we go out this week, Lord, keep your word on our hearts to know that you are the giver of all things good. To know that you're in control. Not to look at what we're doing as a bragger, but Lord, know that we're here to glorify your name. To know that any good that comes from us or goes into us is from you. And we thank you for your love and mercy, for your never-ending grace. Father God, you truly are our daddy. We love you. Thank you, Lord. We thank you for the Whitleys. It's so fabulous to stand back and look back at all that's happened in this process, Lord. We truly feel that you have led us to him and him to us, that family. Lord, we ask that you be involved in the process that still has yet to come. We ask that this transition be smooth, that the church would feel the same connection that we feel on the elder board. Lord, have your hand upon this church. Keep us in your word and glorifying your name. Pray all these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.